It's difficult to talk about the lifetime of our request without taking into account very different abstraction levels on the lifetime. So that is actually how I ended up structuring the talk. There is going to be four different layers where we talk about how requests go through the system. By the way, I'm Enrique. I'm on the open source side of things, on the core team, and I developed the open source gateway. So this talk is going to be mostly about that, but I might insert some parts about the enterprise side of things as well. So going into the infrastructure, this is going to be a very high level view. You are most certainly familiar with this. This is the usual setup when you have a client-server architecture in the World Wide Web, or in the case using Kong's parlance, a consumer and an API that gets consumed. This is literally a worldwide level structure. Requests and responses routinely go over the Atlantic Ocean or other land masses every day. So what happens when you put Kong in the middle is that Kong acts as a reverse proxy. It does nothing by default, which is good. It's more or less transparent. This schema is used a lot to explain how things work, but it's far from complete. On the side of the consumer, on the left, what you really end up having is lots of consumers. That is why we need a consumer entity in Kong. And on the right, you have the same thing. You don't have one single API, you have many. And that is why we need a service entity on Kong to differentiate between those. Even in the middle, that is not as simple. On a real production system, it is not unusual to have multiple Kong nodes working together in a cluster. And before them, there is a load balancer, which even sometimes it's also a Kong node. So obviously we could make a whole talk about how to organize this on Kubernetes with Docker images or other things related with infrastructure, but that is not what this talk is about. So I'm going to restrict it to a single Kong node, and that is the next step on the presentation of the next chapter. So now we are not on a planet-wide level, we are on a country level. A node is more or less a country. It says Germany here, it can be a country, a state on the United States as well. This country in particular is very concerned about efficiency, doing things as fast as possible with the least resources possible. So the way things got started was by looking at what was available, which was the operating system. So in a modern operating system, the largest unit of execution is called a process. They are expensive to make. They are expensive to switch over to when you have several cores, or you can do multitasking, and they cannot share memory with each other. They can, however, have child processes. There is this special instruction in the OS called fork that makes a copy of the process and also makes a copy of the memory of the process. So this is a way of sharing memory, but it's a one-way way. You cannot share memory back upwards. And it is still somewhat expensive, even switching between siblings is expensive. The next thing that operating systems gives you are threads. Threads are less expensive. They're cheaper to create and to switch over to, but they're still not free. One process can have many of them. They can share memory, which is an advantage that we will talk about a bit later, but they can get blocked. And when a thread gets blocked, performance is lost. The thread blocked is not a huge loss, but when all threads in a process get blocked, you can have potentially a big performance loss because the process gets switched. And as I said before, that's more or less expensive. So is there a way to avoid both of them? That was the initial question that was asked. And it turns out there is. We'll see about how to do that. In Kong, there is an initial or master process that is in the node country. The master process is a city or capital city like Paris. And it does a lot of very critical things like loading the initial configuration and setting the initial memory layout that then will get copied. This includes the Lua virtual machine and other things. But its most important job is to create and manage. Manage in this case mostly means resurrecting if one of them dies, workers. So what are the workers? Workers are child processes from the master process. This means that they get a copy of the memory that was initialized by the master process, but it's a copy. It's not shared, or at least not shared upwards. They have this very special setup in which they are single-threaded, and their main task is to actually do the work, to transmit and work with requests. The interesting thing about them is that they are built with what's called non-blocking I/O, which basically means that they never get blocked. So that's how we avoid the problem I was telling about some slides ago. Now we're going to do another deep dive. We're going to go inside one of those threads. If we were on a city level before, now we are on a district or even office building level. So one of these worker threads initially is empty, and that empty space is, we call it connection or connections. They are available connections. And what happens after this worker is created is that a request arrives to Kong, and eventually it arrives to one of those available connections. So you get an unblocked or new connection that needs to be treated. Since we are a thread, we can start processing it. And that's why we changed the color. But while we are processing, new requests come and get basically put into a queue. Once we get blocked, we blocked on the connection, but the thread itself can continue processing other available connections, for example, this one. And this process continues again and again until we get to a place like this, where we have several available unblocked connections that are waiting for the thread to do the work on them. We'll talk about what this work means a bit later. And we also have some blocked connections. Maybe I should talk a little bit more about what blocking means. On the operating system, blocking means things that take time. It can be reading from the hard drive a file, or it can be sending a request through the network and waiting for the response. Those things on the traditional operating system tend to block threads. But here, they block the connections, but the thread can continue processing. Now, there is one more wrinkle into this setup, which is that some of those blocked connections are called keep alive. This is related with TLS or secure connections. When one of these connections is established, there is what's called an SSL handshake. And that process is not super expensive, but it has some cost. So in order to save processing speed, we sacrificed a little bit of memory by keeping those connections open. So if a new, sorry, if a, the same customer with the same SSL properties arrives, we can start serving him immediately without having to redo that SSL handshake again. So that's why some of them are blocked, even if they are not actively being worked on. And there is yet another wrinkle on this setup, which is timers. Every worker has a list of timers, which are pieces of code that need to be executed on a schedule. So sometime in the future, some of them are recurrent, so they happen again and again, like every 1 second or every 10 seconds. This piece of code needs to be executed. And that execution, it's also done by that single thread we have been talking about. So this is how it looks when the thread is executing one of those timers. Notice that when a timer is being executed, no connection is being executed. So this means that if you create too many timers, you might have a problem in performance. This actually has happened in the past. One pattern that we have learned very painfully to avoid is creating one timer per connection. That's what used to happen in our health checks, if my memory serves, and that has been changed, so that doesn't happen anymore. But what ended up happening is that we ended up creating so many timers that the performance got degraded because the connections were not being served appropriately or fast enough. Okay, and that does it for that level. We are going to talk about time now, and then we'll keep digging downwards in the abstraction layer.